love that they let the out.
A very good track, this. The band are nothing but thieves. The track is Graveyard Whistling. What an accomplished sound for such a young band. That's really good.
Nice.
That tracks sound patronising. You can download that track for free if you want to. On the Hugh Stevens free download, just go to bbc.co.uk/introduce.
Find a great track.
The Nothing.
The O2 Arena is the best venue in the UK to me. It is hard to beat that. When we got an email from Anna with our prospective tour dates coming through, and you look down, I go straight to London, and when it said London...
And it was like we would have got that email like 2 years before. It was like a pre-planning email.
Absolutely.
So we were like, absolutely, like, really? That's not going to happen.
It seems so far out of reach. Like, you don't think it's going to happen. I think we always live our lives like that. Like, this is punching a bit, isn't it?
I think it's because we like have a lot of grounded people around us, and we knock each other down in a good way. So it's like we do see those sort of things as like still like absolutely bonkers. Like if we put another one on, I'd be like, nah, you know, yeah. Like we just did it. But like it's healthier to be like that, I think. Start. Oh, it's gonna be so good. I am so excited.
Anna, our agent Anna, she's always like thinking ahead. And I feel like in some ways I like to get involved in that sort of thing. Like, as I mentioned before, when we're on tour, I really like to be present in the moment, because I feel like, you know, that we might never do this ever again. But those conversations do happen really early, and they're always quite enjoyable, because when you go into those conversations, you know you're going to hear something like quite exciting, like something that you've probably not even like even sort of dare to think about. But I guess that comes from having a good agent and good managers.
We had the opportunity to play it with Muse a couple of times, and you get a small taste of what it would be like to headline it. And we never once thought that we would get to it, even when we were doing those gigs.
Welcome.
Turn that racket off.
Anytime. Have a great gig, guys.
Cheers, mate. Oh, you got it. All
right. Oh, two.
Now I'll take London.
Well, good morning, guys.
Yeah.
Your engines.
I thought that we could do an O2 back on the Muse tour. Because when we were going to the Muse shows and just seeing them in that venue, seeing them in an arena, really is what it was, and seeing how they were able to own the stage and how they were able to translate to a big crowd and even win a crowd over that, like not even half, most of them had no clue who Nothing But Thieves were at that time.
With Muse, I think that's a key point where you can't always put a band on an arena support. It's just not beneficial to quite a lot of artists. Right. They'll get lost on the stage and it just doesn't work. So you have to make sure that a band is ready for this kind of tour. And they totally were, and they own the stage, and that's when you knew they're ready as a band. But ultimately, we still had a few years to go. We still had a few more records to get through and to make sure you naturally progress to a point where you're comfortable with a big arena like that.
I don't know if Anna mentioned to me about doing the O2 at Ali Pally. I might have been a bit too drunk. Because we were just on such a high after that show that like I couldn't even contemplate it.
It's a big day, Connor.
Hey, that's a fucking crumb.
Brother!
Man, I can't
stop crying.
It's hard, mate.
It's so wrong with you.
It's a big day.
It's the biggest
of
big, I think.
We're always talking about what the next tour is going to be. I mean, O2 had to be moved because of the pandemic so many times. I mean, we had the O2 show booked in
for like 2020.
Yeah, it was a bit surreal, wasn't it? I remember Steph, after Ali Pally, Steph mentioned about the O2 to me while I was playing Battlefield. And I was just like, look, love, I don't want to hear it now.
Never in the land in mind. Still
Yeah, when we played the bar fire,
it felt different, didn't it?
Yeah, because it was the first time people were in the audience who we didn't know.
Yes.
It wasn't just like your dad or like my mum.
Literally,
or...
we used to. I think it was my dad and Dom's mum for a very long time, like, and a dog occasionally.
Yeah.
You know, it was. We played to no one, and then Barfly. I think maybe I don't know if we just started releasing. Like we had a bit of Zane Lowe traction.
Yeah, with, Radio 1 had just started picking us up, I think.
Graveyard, maybe. Yeah, Graveyard Whistling Emergency. And I think maybe we just had a little bit of traction. So we weren't used to playing to proper crowds. It actually felt like an actual decent gig. It was really good.
There was just a moment in the pre-chorus where it goes just down to the piano and you sing quite softly. And then the crowd was singing along and it was the first time that had ever happened.
Right.
And it was one of those things where you're like, yeah, there's actually, we have what I believe are called fans now.
Yes.
Which seemed alien to us at that point. In terms of turning points, when there were more people that we, every gig we played, it seemed that incrementally more people were coming, which was great for us.
I do feel like Barfly felt like a turning point. It felt like, okay, this is a band who's got a gig on and people are going to it now, rather than we're going to show up and play a venue and see if people are going to come.
Yeah.
You know, that was a good feeling for everyone.
Used to, let's go.
It was insane, that moment. Like, that was a huge moment for us. That was the first, like you said, the first song we really thought we were nothing but thieves with. And then to play that song for ourselves at the O2 was just mind-blowing. It's moving for us. It's been, you know, an incredible journey. And at times, like, you know, a real slog at times. You know, we've like worked really hard. So it was a moment of like pride for us as well as like release. Yeah, you know, it was the pinnacle to get to, and we did it somehow.
Putting Graveyard on the set list was for that reason, really. It felt right to kind of for the song, but also it's kind of important for us to remember those sort of things, like, and actually like put a marker in it. Which I guess is why I kind of cried.
Yeah.
Like a little baby.
it was really beautiful, didn't he?
It was so nice. Yeah, it was so nice. And, you know, that's what it means, though. And like,
yeah, that is it. I don't think we can really kind of express it. I think Connor in that moment probably summed it up for all of us.
Bursting with talent.
To be fair, for me, mate, it just felt completely normal. I know that sounds almost like arrogant. I don't mean it to be, but I'm just like that. TV things is way more pressuring than playing a gig at the O2, because you've got some like producer guy like there, like, okay, you gotta hit the playback in 5 seconds, and then he's gonna say your name, and then you gotta press it, okay? Don't mess it up, kid. And like, you're just like, no.
forget it. It gets under your skin.
There was like, so I was working for National Grid at the time when we were like first, you know, doing shows or whatever, like when I first joined. And I remember driving home from work back to Southend, and Itch was on the radio, which had just come off the EP. And I remember just feeling like, that's really strange, because that was before we'd attempted to give it a push. Like someone had just kind of like, whoever the DJ was, can't remember. I remember just being like, this is wild. It was on Radio 1 just really randomly. But that was the first time I had like, where I was like, this is actually connecting with DJs and with people now. It's a problem, like they're just playing it for because they love it.
Welcome to BBC Radio 1. You are live, don't swear.
Nice to see you again.
Hello. Nice to see you guys too.
Annie.
Yo.
30th of October, Electric Ballroom. If you're around. Ooh. If you're around.
How fun. Let me have a look.
It's a Friday.
Take care. I'm so sorry I won't be able to come in.
Really good.
Oh, no, it's fine. You've got commitments. You've got a real job.
Bloody radio. See you, Dom. Take care.
See you,
thanks, guys. See you. I get my love and it just sounds like trip, trip, switch, switch, switch. What we do when the power's up? What do we do when the light's off?
Yeah, the Electric Ballroom, particularly. That's a prestigious venue. There's a lot of bands that I've seen there and a lot of great gigs, and everyone kind of passes through there in some capacity. And it's like a weird mental numbers thing that when you hit a venue that's 1,000 cap, in your head, you're like, this is bigger than we ever thought we'd get. It's right. It's quite a big number to me. Like 1,000 just seems like a goal in a way. And we would never look too much further than our immediate goal, do you know what I mean? Yeah. We'd always just be like, oh, that seems kind of within reach, let's stay there and not like, you know, push our dreams too far into the unattainable, do you know what I mean?
I think they've proved that they have real longevity.
That's exactly.
And yeah. I think we always saw the longevity in what they were doing. Mm. And to help them, I guess, build their careers off that is like a total pleasure.
And well, it's funny because I remember the first meeting that we had here. And the publicist at the time was like, well, where do they fit in?
Yeah, I remember that meeting so well. I was just like, why do we have to pick now?
Yeah, we're like, well, there's like a few places they fit in. But no, you have to pick one. Like, literally, you have to pick one. And we're like, but they do this kind of stuff and they do that kind of stuff. And we were being told, like, no, you need to pick one genre. And we were like, well, but this band is beyond one genre. And because even at that point, we saw the appeal.
You're my kingdom with desire. When it's more than no one, something that you do to me. So sorry for what I've done.
close now, Joe.
Summer.
Every time.
I don't know what the timeline, I can't remember the timeline of when we played Rockin' Roma with Muse, but I do remember feeling that that was like 10 leagues above what we were used to in any capacity, and we just played these little club gigs, and then it was like, oh, you've got an opportunity to do this random one-off show with Muse to the biggest crowd we probably ever played to, really, or one of them.
Yeah.
I think that gave us a lot of confidence.
Phil, are you ready, Phil? Phil?
Yeah. They're waving at me. I don't even know who I am.
It's just like the Dome, but a bit bigger.
It's like Chinnery's in Southend, but with people in it.
And a massive fucking video wall.
Yeah.
We were really, really small at the time. So how many people was that? Mental. It felt like it was
tens of, it felt like thousands of people.
Yeah, it felt like it was Rome, like that we were playing to. And like we really like it was a massive jump. This show, like, you know, in theory we should not have been booked for a show like this at that point of our career. And like I still remember the excitement of when we came off stage, just feeling like really proud that we'd overcome that obstacle of like, how are we going to entertain this many people? Like it was beyond what we could see.
It's fucking happening, guys.
When I saw them at that show, that was also the moment. And again, like there have been other moments where, you know, I've always known, and I've always, not that I've known, but I've always felt that this band could play big stages like that. But it was at that Muse Rock and Roma show. And that exact moment during I Get High that you're talking about, where everybody in the crowd had their phones up and the lights were on, the flashlights were on. And it was just like, this is what they're meant to be doing.
The other really special thing was our sound guy and tour manager at the time, Jerry, who's an absolute legend. Shout out Jerry, Minister Jerry. He actually got like emotional during playing If I Get High. He got really upset. He was like, this is a special moment. Everyone got their lights out and everyone was like vibing it, swaying along. And it was just, yeah, a proper special moment.
Yeah, it was incredible. There.
And like you say, confidence boost for sure.
Huge, like, yeah.
This actually went well.
Like, we definitely should have been booked for that.
It's quite difficult being in a band, knowing when you've achieved something in some ways. When you write a song, like, is that good? Like, have I done something that's, like, real? Or is that just something else to add to the pile? We moved something that day. Like, it was something, we were a certain place, and then after we'd done that gig, we were in a different place, and that was quite cool to know.
Oh my God, yeah, you like, wanted to know one of my most proud, great. My proudest moment? That was fucking it. You guys fucking killed it. You
so ready for photos.
Killed it. You killed it.
Yeah, that stage was just perfect.
I don't even know what to say. I'm just shaking, mate. I'm just shaking. I'm fucking shaking.
We'll be right back.
like a dream and not so long. I left my heart in Amsterdam.
See it from out front. I'm on the stage, but I hope it looks good. Basically, we've got this stuff. I'm told it's called Kinesis. It's just a posh word for stuff that moves up and down on the stage.
So, because we actually live not, well, a bunch of us live not too far, and we'd been on the road for like a week, so everyone was like, we need to go have showers in our own place and, you know, just like completely zone out. But I thought I need to actually kind of like stare at the beast a little bit and just like make it less scary for me. And it didn't really work, to be honest. I was up in the stands for a little while just looking at, do you know, that was the thing that kind of blew my mind the most actually on the day, was just like the, I don't know, like 100 people or whatever, like building the stage for us.
Yeah.
I was like, who are all these people? It went from, you know, like from Sweeney, Gary to Jen, like to our crew, to like, who are all these people? It was wild.
There were so many times where we would sit and we would go, okay, well, you're gonna play here in London this year, and then next year you're gonna be at this venue, like Roundhouse next year. And they'd be like,
yeah.
Well, we're not gonna be able to sell that out, or it was always nerves as to whether or not people are gonna show up, and we were always the ones who were like, calm down.
I think you got this. Everything that we did was always like a natural progression. So it was like 200 cap to 500 cap, I think, to 1200 cap, to 2300, to doing 6,000, then Brixton. Sorry, Brixton, then 6,000. So it wasn't, nothing was like a huge leap for them, I don't think. So we knew they had the fan base and we knew we'd built it right. So I think even going into Brixton, which is a really big play for a band, like their first headline Brixton is like a super special like event, but I was never nervous about that show.
Forum, it was kind of like, because they'd done, I think, the Electric Ballroom before, the Forum was like kind of like, yeah, this is all right. And it's quite an interesting place to play the Forum, because it's an old theatre. But I didn't really get anything that there was any nerves or anything like that. Brixton was completely different. Brixton was where they were like, fucking hell, there's 5,000 people in here. And I saw the nerves then. I definitely saw the nerves. And I remember walking them on, and I was like, all right, yeah. High fives, and then psh, they went on, and they came off, and they were just bouncing around. That was the bit, and I was like, right, they're ready now.
I think probably the Brixton Academy headline show was the one that proved that to me. It was sort of really early in the first year working for them in December of 2016. It was just an amazing show. So yeah, I think that would be the one where we were like, right, this is going to go somewhere. The first record had a really good following, but then they debuted a few new songs at that show, and then it was just a sign of things to come from the next record. So before Broken Machine, there was like, they played Design and it just kicked off, and we were like, yeah, this is obviously going to be great.
Ali Pally was like the, you know, when we did Brixton, that was like the benchmark. Now that was it, we've hit Brixton. And then we did Ali Pally, it was like, right, that is our venue now. we've done this. And then just to hear like, oh, we can potentially go and do this venue, it's just like, it was almost too much.
I think from, say, Electric Ballroom onwards, yeah, every one of those shows afterwards is like an episode of This Is Your Life. Everyone you know who comes to the show, like all your friends, like family, they're just a huge, huge party. And you don't want to talk about what's next after that. You just want to enjoy
the moment. Yeah, all you get all night is, how was that? And it's just like, good.
I think it really helped that we had played there a couple of times with Muse. You kind of get your head around it a little bit. And although we didn't really believe that we'd be able to do it ourselves, you know, actually allowed to play the O2 without Muse being there, it definitely made us feel a little calmer about the whole experience, I think.
when no one's been to a gig for years, you feel like...
Especially at that level.
Everyone deserves a good night.
And
sadly, it's up to us to guarantee that. So we put a lot of rehearsals in place. Like, we did way more than we normally would. And we were just running the songs over and over and over again and just changing things, like constantly asking ourselves, like, is that the right guitar tone? Have we got the right things going
production
on?
Production as well, isn't it?
It's
like, you can't turn up with a, you know, little
a disco
light
ball
bulb, yeah.
From Argos.
Hey, where's If I Get Hot? That's not on, so.
It was really difficult making a set list for this tour. I think because we had released Moral Panic and then Moral Panic 2 before we haven't got to tour any of it because of COVID. There were just a lot more songs to fit in. Just because as we get more material, sort of like our tastes evolve and some songs that we liked at the time probably don't like so much now. Neil Brother.
Yeah, it's up there.
Other songs that have probably gone out of favour with us have probably come back into our tastes again. So that is, we've been a band so long that has actually happened now. So. But it was good. Especially on this tour, we had like 3 main set lists that changed quite a lot per night. And that kept it fresh for us, and it kept it... I mean, we have a lot of fans that come to every single show we like put on, so it was kind of nice to ensure that they're not going to see the same thing every night, and you know, there's a bit more spontaneity in it.
I mean, I think we should play If I Get High if we can, because I think it'd be good to have another softer song, and I think it'll work well in these venues. And it's just our fans still listen to that quite a lot.
Yeah, we kind of should be taking out one song as a bit of a favourite, so we can bring it back at some point. We just play everything at the moment. But I actually think maybe we should do a different version of Particles and give it like a bit of a sing-along vibe or something.
We've done a load of rehearsal, and we never rehearse as well because we're always on fucking tour. But we did so much rehearsal like for these shows, and we're like, we are going to make these shows like the best they can possibly be.
I know one thing from the band's point of view is picking a set list is very difficult. Having so many great tunes spanning 3 albums and the EPs that came along with it as well, it's very difficult, and it must be hard for them to please all the fans because, you know, you've got to have some structure to the set and there's only so much rotation you can do, but it's obviously going to get more difficult as it goes on. And then, like, where do you go from that? Is it multiple nights at the O2 Arena? Will it be stadiums? You never know.
that, that I bleed. Tell me that there's some way that I'll get through the night.
I had this really weird thing on the day after the O2. I don't even know how to describe it, but it felt like we just like completed a game, and then the new version of the game hadn't even been announced, and you were like, a bit like, now what? It felt like I've been playing this game and leveling up, like, just, and then I was like, now what's the next goal?
I think we all had an emotional come down, like literally. I think I remember we all text each other and be like, this is a very odd feeling.
Yeah,
you know, not like obviously.
I think I'm sad.
It was kind of sad. Yeah, it was.
I wish I could do this every day.
Yeah, but you're right though. It was always the goal, the O2.
And it doesn't by any means mean like we're done now.
It stopped, yeah.
But it just, you know, in our heads, it's like, well, it doesn't get much bigger than that in London until you do multiple nights at venues and stuff like that, you know, might be the next thing to do. But
you're right, that was it. That's probably why it was so emotional for all of us on stage, because it was like a 10-year build-up. And, you know, we started as best mates. It sounds cheesy, but like we're literally family. And so you've done that.
Some of us literally are family.
You literally are with Phil. Yeah. That's so dumb. Yeah. Sorry.
Obviously, we're so conscious of ever seeming like we're an arrogant band, because we're not. We keep ourselves level-headed. But like...
Pretending,
yeah, really, yeah. For sure. But like, I don't know if I can say like it felt, you know, like it was really, like it was earned. But I feel like we did it justice. And I feel like we put everything into it, and I think we were so happy in ourselves for what we'd achieved. It didn't feel like we'd done it too early. We're so many years into our career now. It felt like just the right time, and that we did it justice, like for ourselves. I think that's probably the most important thing, really, is that we felt like we did the best that we could.
Wow, what now? But yeah, we're building those goals up again.
Yeah, I think like it's once you've done a gig like that, you're then like, we just... the next album has to be at a certain level. You can't play an arena, yeah. And you can only blag it so far, right? We've got to try and put out a record that just blows everything else out of the water. Hashtag pressure. Hashtag, I just said hashtag.
You have to remember, we're halfway through a tour at this point as well, right? We've got other shows we've got to play. We can't be like patting ourselves on the back and be like, oh, how good were we at that show? Like, we've got another show to come up, and it's got to be just as good as the one we've just done. So I think we enjoyed that night and, well, the next day, but and then it was back to it. It was back to like performing all the best show we can.
Yeah. London. Is everybody going crazy? Yeah.
it was just such an emotional moment, just saying, like, thinking, like, I just knew it. Like, I knew you could do it, and you did it. It was like 15 years of you know, hoping and wishing for something just came true, and, like, just the tears started pouring out. It was like this sense of pride, and I'm getting emotional talking about it now. It was like this sense of pride and accomplishment, and, like, you know, it's not often that you see that kind of loyalty with a band either. Like, we've been with them since day one.
It didn't surprise me. No, it didn't take me back. Oh, I can't believe. And it's not necessarily that, like, it's like Nothing But Thieves is like, oh, I'm really into the music. So it doesn't really matter if you're into the music or not. It obviously fucking helps. But it's how I see them working. They all work incredibly hard. They've all got a different role. There's so much more that goes on just as me getting the drawing, doing the rigging plot, getting a load of crew in, setting it up and all that. There is kind of a magic around it. There's a family around it, which I'm sure there is with every other band, but I think it's different with Nothing But Thieves, I really do. If you've got that work ethic with talent, which is obviously the first most important thing, and you've not got, you know, your head up your ass, and you will stand with fans and do autographs and do this and do that, you've got to, you know, you're going to be successful, aren't you? And yeah, good on them.
Do you know what? I feel like a newborn baby. I could shit my pants or cry or throw up at any point, basically. Which is so exciting. It's the Holy Trinity. But yeah, no, I'm buzzing. A Molotov cocktail of emotions, to be honest. I'm figuring it out.
We kind of didn't really think it was going to happen for a long time, did we?
No, it just felt like a little bit of a pipe dream. And we know, like, we're really, really close with our crew, and we know how much of a big deal it is for all of them. We've been with this same crew for quite a few years now, and we've all kind of gone up together and gone through these hurdles, especially people like Gary, our front of house, and Stu, our stage manager. Like, they've had to up their game as we've had to up ours.
Yeah, they've surpassed us in a lot of ways.
I mean, God, like, we've been with this crew for plus 8 years, some of them. So they're a family. They've worked their asses off to get us here when we had no budget for touring, nothing. We couldn't even pay ourselves. They just did it from the start for pennies. But you know what you say, if you feed them, if you give them peanuts, you get monkeys. So that's what we have. And they're all wonderful and crazy.
Band are walking to stage.
Come
on,
you're
alright.
Just
look at you're fucking there.
I'm going to be sick.
Yeah, it's not for that, mate.
Oh, yes.
I can hear him.
Come on,
look at
the boys.
Big job to do.
We're
going to
have fun.
Don't fuck it up. There's no one there. Play your banjo, yeah?
Yeah, we've done it, boys.
We cracked the fucking code.
I finally succumbed.
You've just been a part of the best night of our entire lives. Thank you so much. I'm lost for words for once. Thank you. I just want to say, again, thank you for supporting us. Thanks for coming down. We fucking love you. We've been Nothing But Thieves, you've been London. We'll see you again soon. We love you. We love you, baby. All right. I want to hear you singing your heart out. This song's called Impossible. To the breath that I go, felt the moment set aside. I couldn't wait to tell you why. I'm standing here with this awkward smile, and that's because thank you again. Get home safe.